that's where we're going to set the wire speed here. So it basically just went up one heat range when we're butting the two of these together. One thing you want to check as well, which I was just looking at, is you want to make sure that after you do your spot welds, it's stopped. A lot of times there's a little ball on the end of this, just a little bit of molten metal that was left on the end of the welding wire. Because that is thicker than the welding wire, it takes a little more heat to get that melted in. So your first little bit of weld may actually be a little cold because you can't get it to flow out. So I like to try and clip off the end so we get a fresh piece of wire before we start again. So we have our piece here. And I'm going to do another spot weld or stitch weld on here. Now that is how I like to do it. I'll show you guys. We got 100% penetration. That's the back side. Now what I really want to show you guys, this is really killer. This is what I love. I don't know if Joe can get that on there. Look how flat that weld is. Flat, man. I mean, that requires almost no grinding. We'll turn it a little bit so you can see. It's nice and flat, and you don't have a lot raised up over top of the panel. That's because I turned the heat range up to get it a little hotter, so I could really melt it in there and melt the two of them together. So that's what you want. I mean, that's almost a factory looking spot weld if you do that on, you know, if you're putting together a pinch weld or something. If you can get your machine set up like that, you could fool some guys with that. So I'll tell you what, I like to set it together, set up the machine and weld it together to get those nice flat welds like that. And again, that's part of the key of setting your machine up ahead of time. If you sit there and play with your settings, get it just right, it'll save you some hassle. You know, you'll start off with the machine set up just on point and you'll have nice welds like that. So that's 100% penetration. One weld that we did earlier, and I just wanted to show you guys, I set the machine up incorrectly. There's a one on this one I set up too cold. This is either from holding the MIG gun too far away, or maybe the settings on the machine were incorrect. Or you could have had that little ball on the end of the wire like I was talking about. And you could see that it's kind of raised really far up above. There's like a ball kind of raised over top of it. So you want to try and avoid that. We did get penetration through, sort of, but you're going to have to grind most of your welds on top of the panel, so you're going to grind 90% of your weld away because of that, and you're going to lose your rigidity because it's not really melted into both pieces. It's kind of sitting on top. So if your welds are looking like that, where they're sitting real proud or, you know, sitting tall on top of the panel, dialing machining, get it a little, turn it the heat up a little bit, or turn your wire speed down a little bit to get it just right, because that's not what you want. And you're gonna put excessive heat into the panel by grinding that. So that's a cold weld. Next thing I was gonna show, and I'll do it on this one we have with no gap here, just to show you the process. When you're welding a panel together, you're gonna be doing what's basically called stitch welding. So you're going to be welding a bunch of these little spot welds over top of each other. You're going to be overlapping them. When you're doing a panel repair, especially if it's an exterior repair, but most anywhere, you want to completely seal up that gap that you're welding together. So if you leave a gap or a pinhole that you don't weld up, that's an area that moisture can get in, rust can start, and even though you're going to prime it or coat it, still can be some moisture that can get in there and rust out from the inside. So I would try and weld the whole entire panel. The way to do that is with stitch welding. You're going to weld a few in a row, and then you're going to jump around to another spot and let that area cool, and you're going to jump to another spot, weld a little more, and jump around. So I'll show you, I'll do three or four here in a row, and then we'll show you what it looks like on this piece here. That's a little hot, but.
Let's see if we can rub that off real quick. There we go. You can see.
So you can see there's no gap in between there. I was overlapping, step back stepping each of my welds. And I'll turn it again. We're pretty flat. You know, those welds aren't sitting up real tall like they were on that other piece we just showed you. Now, they're still pretty flat. Not much grinding you're gonna have to do there. You're not gonna have to do a ton of grinding to get that smooth. You know, you can go over that a couple passes. It'll be pretty smoothed out. And then from there you can move on and you know, your next piece. Now one thing you wanna, actually, let's show you here as well. Here's your backside. You're getting that 100% penetration that we're talking about. So these pieces are completely fused together. They're not, the weld's not just sitting on top. We're nice and fused together. The one thing you have to remember though is you're fighting warpage the whole entire time. We'll turn this off here so you can hear a little better. So you're fighting warpage the whole entire time that you're doing this. So when you're welding like that, you're gonna do maybe 2, 3, maybe 4 quick stitch welds like that, and you're gonna wanna let that cool. You're gonna jump to the next spot. A trick you can do if you're trying to keep the panel cool, you have to do those couple of stitch welds. You can use a little air nozzle and hook your air line up and just blow off that area you were doing. What that's doing is you're cooling the piece back down. You're keeping the heat soak from spreading. So you're sort of minimizing the warpage. A common misconception that a lot of people have is that they think that if they cool the piece down, or if they put water on it or something like that, they can completely stop warpage. And it's just not possible. Warpage happens no matter what. It's just a matter of how much warpage will happen. If you're welding on two flat pieces like this with no structural rigidity around them, you're going to get warpage. No matter how much you try with trying to cool each piece, you're going to get a little bit of warpage. You can reduce it by using this. I do not suggest using water, especially if it's something that's bare metal, because what are we doing? We're trying to fight rust or trying to stop rust. Well, by introducing water onto a bare metal part and a weld that's a virgin clean metal weld, you're already putting moisture into it and starting the rusting process. Even on a molecular level, you're still starting that. So I like to use compressed air because it's generally, if you have a good drying system, you're not going to have too much water in the air, and you're just cooling it down, and then you can move on. So you can cool the area down, or you can just let it cool on its own, depending how much heat you put into it. Jump over to an area that's pretty far away. Usually the way I do it is I take my glove off, and if I can touch the panel and it's not hot to the touch, then I can do a little bit of welding. If it's just barely, you know, lukewarm, you'll be okay. But if it's hot to the touch, do not start welding back on that piece again. You need to let it cool down. You either need to walk away, you need to cool it with the air nozzle, or do something to get that panel back down. Because if you keep welding on it, that heat effect, the heat effect zone is going to go, out like that, and then your whole panel is going to be warped, and you got a mess on your hands. So, last couple things is just some tips and tricks or some tools that I like to use that are really helpful, other than the ones we just talked about. One of these little pneumatic angle grinders like this are really great. I keep one of these handy at all times. I really like these for sanding welds. So I'll throw a little 36 grit sanding disc on it. And what I do is when you're sanding your welds, you want to be sanding across the weld like that to just knock down any high spots. So you want to try not to be gouging. If you can, if you have a sanding disc that's really good, a fresh one, you can get in and sand just on the weld. But you got to be really careful, because if you get off that weld a little bit, then you're sanding into your fresh metal on either side. You're going to start making the metal really thin, and it's going to crack around it. So a lot of times I'll quickly hit it like this across the weld. It'll show me where there's any high spots, sand those down. And but yeah, this guy's really handy to use. Another thing that if you're just learning or you're a beginner and you want to, you're a little intimidated about doing the stitch welding or the spot welding, we have a spot weld kit that has this cool little nozzle here that you can put onto this. And what this does, it has these little legs here. That's the key. what you do is you unthread your standard nozzle, and this fits any Tweco style torch. So if you have a MIG welder other than an Eastwood that has Tweco consumables, you should be able to use this tip here. So you thread it on like that, and we'll cut our excess off here. And then let me do that over. So we'll cut this down just a little bit. So you thread this guy on in place of the Tweco nozzle. This fits any welder, even if you don't have an Eastwood. If it has Tweco consumables, you can use this. What you do with this is it sets the perfect height for doing a spot weld, just like this. So I'll turn this so you guys can see there in video land. So you can see the, this sets your height, and you can hit the trigger and get a perfect spot weld or stitch weld every time. So you don't have to think about it. You know, you can jump around, boom, your height's set, boom, your height's set. That's a big issue that beginners have, is setting their height. They're too high or they're too low, and they're melting the wire to the tip. So with this, you get that perfect height, and push down on the piece like that, hit your trigger, boom, zap, you got a really nice spot weld. So it uses the same settings, just it's a cool way to set your height off of the panel. And you can just swap back to your normal one if you're doing normal welding or you don't need it. So the other part of that kit that's handy, there's these spot weld pliers. So what these are good for is if you're welding two pieces together where you're doing like a pinch weld or something like that, where you're doing a true spot weld or a plug weld where you're drilling a hole through the top piece, you can use these. It clamps the two pieces of metal together tightly. And the cool thing we've done is we've made this nozzle we're talking about, it fits right inside like that. So you can fit inside, you can set, you can pretty much, it's a no-brainer at that point. You just hit the trigger, boom, you got a perfect spot weld. So these come separately, or you can buy this all in a kit, but these are a cool one for doing consistent spot or stitch welds. Next thing we have, we didn't really show them in this video, but these are really great for setting up your panels. These little pinch weld clamps have little thumb screws on the top, and they have a ton of clamping force. It's incredible how much they have. So with these, you can do the edge of a panel and tighten it down, the whole pieces together. I got a ton of these in my box that I use to mock up a panel. You use these for the edge of the panel to keep everything kind of tight or where it needs to be. These are really good to have, not just for pinch welds, but just for general fabrication and setting up a panel. If you're trying to mock something up, you can use these to set a panel in place and see what you need to do. They're extremely handy. You can use them for sheet metal welding. With your MIG, if you're setting up a panel on the edges here, like with this one I used, I clamped the ends with the pinch weld clamps, and I was able to do those first couple tack welds. The other two things that we're going to show you is these panel clamps here, these locking panel clamps. These are really handy. We offer them in a bunch of different sizes. These are my two favorites here. These are great for clamping a panel in place. So if you're doing something large like a quarter panel, or you're doing a big patch, and you need to kind of check your progress to see where it's at, or if it's fitting correctly, or if you're just trying to get a panel, panels parallel and flush, you can use those to bridge the two pieces. You clamp them together. Again, they have great holding power. I would suggest getting as many as you can afford, because an old saying is you can never have too many clamps. When you're working on an old car or doing fabrication. The last thing is, if you're doing small patch panels and you don't want to buy a huge sheet of sheet metal, we do at Eastwood offer a patch panel repair kit in both steel and aluminum. This here is our steel kit. This is actually aluminized steel. So if you think of the exhaust, if you ever got exhaust tubing at an exhaust shop or at a local parts store, has that silverish coating on it, that's exactly what this has on it. That's for corrosion, that keeps it from rusting. So that way, when you're doing your repair, you only need to grind on just the edge you can weld just on the edge, and it's only the area that you're welding that you have to worry about any type of rust forming. That's already got a coating on it that keeps it from flash rusting. So that's really great extra benefit of buying this. It comes with a bunch of different pieces that you can do most general repairs with. You start getting into larger things like quarter panels, door skins, things like that. This might be not quite large enough, but this can take care of most any patch panels that you need to make. You can easily do it with that. It also comes with these strips here that you can use. You can use these as backers. We're using them today just to show you, you know, what we're welding together. But you can use these pieces to back up back of a piece if you're welding, similar to what we did with the backing plate. You can actually weld one of these backing strips to it to help you out if you're a beginner. So that's everything I got today for the basics on MIG welding sheet metal. Hope you guys learned something. If you have any ideas for future tech videos that you'd like to see from us, feel free to drop us a comment in the video or shoot us an email. Don't forget to follow us on YouTube for all of our videos, including the tech, sales, and anything else. And follow us on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram at Eastwood Co. You'll keep up with everything that is Eastwood that's going on every single day. Thanks for watching. We'll catch you next time.